फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू दिस लेक्चर सीरीज ऑन टेक्नोलॉजी, सोसाइटी एंड पॉलिटिक्स। टाइटल ऑफ टुडेज लेक्चर इज फोर्थ इंडस्ट्रियल रेवोल्यूशन। A theme in your syllabus. I'm going to make an argument like this in this lecture. Future technology transforms how you live, work, and think at your own cost. So this is my argument that in the days to come, or in the post-industrial world, some people call fourth industrial revolution, what we are going to witness is that our whole life will change. Technology will change our whole life, and how we live, how we work, and how we think will be changed by technology at our own cost. That will be the new technological model as well as the business model. So it will have certain very serious social consequences, political consequences, cultural consequences. So that is the premise of my lecture for the day. Friends, let us start the lecture. As we know, the word revolution denotes an abrupt and radical change. Of course, revolution has appeared throughout human history. Particularly, when a new technology emerged. An aged inconvenience will be wiped out. So, from that perspective, the first profound shift in our way of living appeared 12,000 years ago. We know what happened then. So 12,000 years ago, our forefathers started domesticating animals. We have transitioned from a foraging community to a farming community. So it was a very big shift in human life. 12,000 years ago, Homo sapiens, we call ourselves Homo sapiens, started a sedentary lifestyle and an agrarian revolution took place. We know animal power and human labor were mixed. Animal power and human labor were mixed. So their combined efforts some 12,000 years ago, which was furnished for purposes of production, transportation, and communication, changed the whole landscape of our living. So little by little, food production improved, spurring population growth, larger human settlements followed. And by 6,000 years ago, we know an urban revolution appeared. And for the first time in human civilizations or human history, cities emerged some 6,000 years ago in the Near East. Memphis, Ur, Babylon, Nineveh. These were some biggest cities of the Neolithic era. And historians call these processes as agrarian and urban revolutions. That was the first type of revolutions humans witnessed. And we know we experienced a third revolution, a major revolution. So the agrarian revolution was a major revolution, urban revolution was a major revolution, and with that scale, we can say Indus Revolution was a third revolution because that changed our whole human landscape. And we know it happened by the mid of 18th century in Britain. Industrial Revolution was a paradigm shift in the history of human living. Why? We know that by Industrial Revolution, mechanization started. When mechanization started, an important quality of human beings were removed from us. What was that? The deployment of muscles, human muscles for generating power was removed. So, Industrial Revolution marked our transition from muscle power to mechanical power. It marked the transition from muscle power to mechanical power. So this was facilitated by Industrial Revolution. Of course, we were always in the attempt to replace muscle from the Paleolithic era itself. But this process got an aggressive pace, an aggressive character in the industrialization era. And historians tell us that first industrial revolution took place between 1760 and 1840. 1760 and 1840, the first industrial revolution. So, industrial revolution was a series of events. It got a first phase, a second phase, a third phase. And historians classify that 1760 to 1840 was the first phase of industrial revolution. So, it was marked by railroad and steam engine. We have discussed that in the last class. Watt's engine, Newcomen engine. And friends, it was in this period mechanical production started. Mechanical production. Or production has been mechanized. And the second industrial revolution, historians argue that spanned between late 19th century and early 20th century. It made production possible. It made production possible. In a mass scale. It made production possible in a mass scale. During the second phase, there was electricity, as well as the assembly line of Henry Ford, and Fordism was born. It appeared during the second phase of Industrial Revolution. And historians argue there was a third revolution. And they argue that it started by 1960s, 1960s. And they say that it is digital or computer revolution. 1960 onwards, computer started to dominate the world. Semiconductors and mainframe computing invented in 1960s. Personal computers, 1970s and 80s. The internet, 1990. Friends, that is three very important industrial revolutions. Before that industrial revolution, we had two other revolutions, the agrarian revolution as well as the urban revolution. And friends, today we are at the beginning of a fourth industrial revolution. A fourth industrial revolution. So the first revolution, steam engine, as well as what may be called railroads. Second industrial revolution, Henry Ford, assembly line of Henry Ford, and the advent of electricity. Third was computers and the internet. And what is the fourth industrial revolution then? So we are thinking, historians are thinking, the historians of technology are thinking, what is likely to be the fourth industrial revolution? So friends, we can ponder over that question. And friends, we are at the beginning of a fourth industrial revolution. And it began at the turn of the 21st century. Of course, it is built on the third industrial revolution, that is computer revolution. So the fourth industrial revolution is an extension of what may be called the third industrial revolution. Or the third industrial revolution was a digital revolution. But friends, fourth industrial revolution is radically different from all previous revolutions. The fourth industrial revolution is radically different from all the major revolutions we had witnessed previously. In the fourth industrial revolution, friends, we are going to witness the ubiquitous mobile internet. The ubiquitous mobile internet. And majority of you are attending this online class because you got a mobile in your hand, which you got internet access. So life is made easy. And smaller and more powerful sensors became widely used in the beginning of 21st century onwards. Moreover, more than all other things, characteristic feature of fourth industrial revolution is the invention of artificial intelligence and machine learning. So fourth industrial revolution got digital technologies that have computer hardware, software, and a network at its core. Therefore, friends, Fourth Industrial Revolution is certainly a break with the Third Industrial Revolution. Therefore, a professor in the Massachusetts Institute of Technology studied the difference between Third Industrial Revolution and the Fourth Industrial Revolution. The professor was Erik Brynjolfsson, and Andrew McAfee. Erik Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee. And they have famously referred to Fourth Industrial Revolution as the Second Machine Age. The Second Machine Age. So an interesting phrase. The Second Machine Age. That is the Fourth Industrial Revolution. According to them, this is not Fourth Industrial Revolution. Rather, it is the Second Machine Age. What is it? So we are intrigued by the usage of the phrase, the Second Machine Age. What is it? We know that over 200 years ago, Industrial Revolution brought about mechanization of activities. And we know 200 years ago, the mechanization of human activities replaced human muscles from engagement in activities. And Erik Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee argue that 200 years ago, there was the first machine age. What was it? Mechanization of human activities. Thereby, humans replaced muscles from activities as much as possible. And sedentary lifestyle increased. And friends, all of us now likes to live without being worked. We don't love to use our muscles for hard labor intensive activities. We don't like that. So humans love to live without the use of muscles. And friends, the astonishing developments in digital and other technologies in the contemporary times are transforming society in a very, very profound manner. And for Erik Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee, the contemporary transformation of our world are not made by simply machines that replace muscles, but by a new type of technology. In this changed scenario of our contemporary time, friends, Homo sapiens, that we call ourselves Homo sapiens, the wise men, Homo sapiens are in the attempt to replace brain from activities. You see, the direction towards which human world is moving. 200 years ago, by the Industrial Revolution, Human activities were mechanized and muscles were displaced. Now, humans are in search of those technologies that help us live without the use of human brain or cognitive power. Okay. Friends, we are already engaged in activities which doesn't require muscle. But humans now love to engage in activities that doesn't require cognitive abilities. Memory. Friends, my mother and my father and my grandpas had a great memory. Because during their lifetime, there weren't so many recording registers. So there weren't mobile phone, there weren't writing apps. Everything humans memorized. Today, none of us are able to remember more than 2 or 3 mobile numbers. Maybe you are able to remember the mobile number of your mother or your husband or your wife or your father. Anyway, we are not in a position to remember more than 10 mobile numbers. And for my case, I think I remember only 2 numbers, my number and my wife's number. I'm not able to remember any other number. But couple of years ago, friends, it was not like that. We were able to remember so many things. Our ability to memorize things, you know, that is lost. And friends, that was a very important human capability. That was a very important human capability that we were able to remember. And that was also an ancient quality. That's why Socrates said, writing will destroy man. Writing will destroy an important human ability. What was that? Socrates said, the discovery of writing will ruin our ability to remember. Now what is happening now, friends? We are not able to remember mobile numbers of, less than 10. I don't think, majority of us are not able to remember mobile numbers. In my case, I told you, I will be able to remember only 2 mobile numbers, my number and the number of my wife. That means, friends, we are happy with it. Why? Because technology assists us. We have so many conveniences being provided by technologies around us, so that we don't need to depend on our memory ability of the brain. We are happy with it and we are not worried about it. It's very normal for us. But it was not, the situation a couple of years ago. I remember when I was doing my post-graduation, I was able to remember many numbers, landline numbers, my neighbor's number, my home number, and my friend's mobile number. Some of my friends had landline. I was able to remember that those days. And friends, now I am not able to remember any of those numbers. That ability is lost. Friends, this is a big turning point in human life. That was first the industrial civilization, where machines replaced our muscle power. Then there is a second machine age. And in this age, second machine age, machines are now able to take over a lot of human cognitive task memory, emotion, speech, recognition skill. That is, when a person walks in front of us, humans are able to identify the face of that person because our eyes and our senses identify who is that person. And we believe that that is only a human quality. And friends, now, today, that is not simply a human quality. Now, machines are able to recognize objects. That's why we got face recognition technologies, speech recognition technologies. Am I audible, friends? Audible?
Yes, sir.
Friends, the second machine age is a time in which human brains are going to be replaced by machines. Friends, this process started in 1997. Technically, this process started in the year 1997. What happened in the year 1997? Some of you may able to, when you were born, 1997? You were born 1997 or 1998? Which year you were born, friends?
98, sir.
Yes. Which year you were born? Am I not audible, friends? Am I not audible?
99.
91. 91.
98, sir.
98. Anymore? 98. Right?
99.
99. Okay. 99. So majority of you are 99 born, friends. Yeah. So you are all born 1999, right? And friends, 2 years ago, 2 years before the time you were born, what happened in the world was that IBM created a computer. IBM created a computer. That computer was called Deep Blue. And this Deep Blue computer beat the famous chess player Garry Kasparov in a chess match in the year 1997. That a computer beat human brain. And Garry Kasparov was a brilliant chess player in the world. Some of you may remember Garry Kasparov. He was a famous chess player. I remember the news. I have read from Malayalam Manorama news paper. And friends, for the first time in human history, humans are networking together with billions of brains, billions of brains. And brains are combined together to solve human problems. You may notice you have artificial intelligence doctor and an AI doctor is far, far better than a human doctor. Why? It is because an AI doctor can analyze billions of patient data, patient scenarios, medical scenarios. An AI doctor can analyze within no time billions of medical scenarios of a patient, which is freely available on the internet, which is freely available on the internet, and you can suggest better medicine because an AI doctor got algorithm for medical analysis. And friends, it is not possible for a human doctor. A human doctor cannot analyze big algorithms which contain enormous data. In the past, friends, only a relatively small share of humanity, only a very small number of human beings were engaged in problem solving. We have seen in the 17th century, from Copernicus to Isaac Newton, some great men changed the history of scientific world. Today the things changed. In the future, friends, in the days to come, almost all the humanity can be partners in the process of problem-solving enterprises. That is fourth industrial revolution. An AI driver is far better than a human driver. An AI driver can analyze millions of possibilities and scenarios before taking a step or decision, so that it can even judge between choices in terms of a likely accident. Which is soon going to happen. Thereby, an AI driver can reduce casualty in accidents, but a human driver cannot. Because a human driver cannot think in the blink of an eye, which an AI driver can do. So a human driver cannot enter into analysis of so many scenarios before his vehicle is going to hit something. And friends, this scenario which Eric Brynjolfsson and Andrew McCaffey says as second machine age, which we otherwise call fourth industrial revolution, is said to be Industry 4.0 in Germany. It's a term coined at the Hanover Fair in 2011. The usage, Industry 4.0, describes that technology will revolutionize the organization of global value chains. What are these global value chains? They are the Internet of Things, big data, cyber physical systems, smart factory. Friends, these technologies will replace our mechanized activities. These things will replace our mechanized activities and people-based systems. Internet of Things, big data, cyber physical systems, as well as smart factories will replace mechanized human activities and people-based systems. Smart factories create a world in which virtual and physical systems of manufacturing cooperate at the global scale. So the fourth industrial revolution, it is not only about smart and connected machines. The scope of fourth industrial revolution is much wider. It is much wider. There are breakthroughs in so many areas, in so many technologies. There are breakthroughs. Friends, there are gene sequencing to nanotechnology, from renewables to quantum computing. So developments are taking place in unprecedented manner. So today we have artificial intelligence all around us. Self-driving cars and drones to virtual assistants and translation software. Artificial intelligence prevails everywhere. This is an important technology of fourth industrial revolution. And AI, artificial intelligence, will certainly change our life. Friends, AI based on algorithm. It is based on algorithm, data algorithm. When you search on Google or YouTube, you are leaving so many potential information about yourself. These information are breadcrumb. It's a technical term, breadcrumb, a scientific term. These information which you leave on Google or YouTube or Facebook or any other places, they are called breadcrumb. And friends, machine learning technologies will learn that, you know, breadcrumb of information which you have left in cyberspaces, which will be used by tech firms. We never know what they are collecting from us. When you search on Google search, or when you do watch some video contents on YouTube, or when you email something, when you scroll down on Facebook timeline, or when you scroll down on your Twitter, or when you do something on your WhatsApp or Instagram, friends, we are not aware of the fact that we are being tracked by so many, you know, what may be called malvirus or other cookies, bugs, they're called bugs. It is injected into your device and you don't know. Your mobile has so many bugs and cookies which are installed in your device without your information. Why? Because when you read a file on you know, Google search, the platform which gives you that reading file also installs in your device some cookies and bugs without your authorization. And such bugs and cookies collect so many information from you. You don't know that. And none of us don't know that. So these bugs and cookies are intelligent robots. They're better brains. They're self-programmed. So they cater to an attention economy. They cater to an attention economy. An attention economy is growing because of artificial intelligence. We know applications such as Apple Siri, they are intelligent personal assistants. And Siri is able to recognize speech. You need not to write anything. You just speak. Siri will do. You simply ask, what's the temperature in Talasheri? Who is the president of Uganda? Where Bijusar is now? Siri will give you information. So friends, today, voice recognition and artificial intelligence are progressing so quickly. So in the fourth industrial revolution, a new scenario is emerging in which humans are talking to computers. That already happened. Humans are talking to machines. Humans are marrying machines. We have already come across news from Europe that some men and women married robots. And that is legalized in Europe. They married, you know, we have heard news that some people married dogs. Couple of years ago, we had heard that some people have married their dogs and legally possible in Europe and other part of the world. Now in Europe and other part of the world, you have seen that, you know, people can marry machines and that is legalized and that is considered to be marriage. So humans will talk to robots, engage with robots, and will have love with robots. And robots will be preferred for humans. These days, people prefer robots than humans. It is creating what some technologists say, ambient computing. Here, ambient computing. Here, robotic personal assistants are taking notes and respond to your queries. Robotic personal assistants are responding to your queries. So, for example, we have a notion of children's moral responsibility towards parents, aging parents. So, when your parents are aging, we will help them. But one day, what happens if you replace yourself with a robot and robots are doing parental care, which you are supposed to do? So the notion of a children's moral responsibility towards parents and grandparents are removed all of a sudden. So our devices, our machines will become increasingly part of our personal and private ecosystems. And one day, friends, you will start saying hello and hey to machines. And it will become much cool stuff in your life. And you will be more comfortable with machines than with humans. Will be more comfortable with machines than humans. And you will trust machines than humans. Because machines are listening to you, anticipating your needs, and it is helping you when required, even if you did not ask. Because machines will never judge you. Machines don't have prejudice. Machines don't have a caste or class or race or gender differences. So we love the machines. So friends, these type of changes are being brought about by some very important technologies. The first one, as I told you, one important technology is driverless car, autonomous car, self-driving cars that will revolutionize the world in the fourth industrial civilization. Then there will be drone technology. And one day you will get, groceries delivered at your doorsteps from sky. Amazon has already, instituted drone delivery trials in USA, and it is already, technologically it is possible. And the only problem is that legally they didn't get sanctioned to deliver, groceries to your home door from sky. So drones will deliver. So drones are going to change the entire human ecosystem, friends. Your children and your grandchildren will be living in a world, where no more humans will be, required. So then 3D printing and 4D technologies are creating a new generation of self-altering products, the 3D and 4D. And robotics, as I told you, will be increasingly used across all areas of life. Then friends, most important technology among all these things is the Internet of Things. IoT, Internet of Things. That is the one of the best inventions of fourth industrial civilization, fourth industrial revolution. That is, the clothes you wear, the footwear you use, the car, the pen, the book, the mobile, the washing machine at your home, the grinder machine in your kitchen, the television set in your living hall, you know, an enormous number of physical objects in and around you, friends, all of these, you know, objects, things will be internet enabled. That means your pen will be internet enabled. Your footwear will be internet enabled. Your dress, your costume, your clothes will be internet enabled in the days to come. So there will be some technologies attached to your cloth, your footwear, your pen, your book. Everything in the world will have internet attached. Friends, you imagine such a scenario. An internet of things world. Everything is being known. Everything is being tracked. So, you know, that is the relationship between things and people will shape a new world. So cheaper and smarter sensors are installed in your home, clothes, accessories, cities, transport, energy network, in manufacturing processes. So billions of devices around the world, such as smartphones, tablets, and computers, are connected to the internet. You already know that car maker, what is called MG Hector. MG Hector says that their car is internet enabled. Their car is internet enabled. So friends, today, am I audible, friends?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So friends, that MG Hector car is internet enabled. Day after tomorrow, you will see a situation in which your grinder machine will be internet enabled. Your refrigerator will be internet enabled. So your washing machine will be internet enabled. See, that scenario is going to happen, friends. Within 10 years, everything, every object in the world will be internet enabled. So that will radically change, friends. That will be radically change the whole ecosystem, the human ecosystem. So friends, and we have blockchain application. So Bitcoin is a blockchain application. So blockchain is a system of recording information in a way that makes it difficult to change, hack, or cheat the system. That is called blockchain. So blockchain app are developing, and Bitcoin is a blockchain app. So at present, this Bitcoin as a blockchain is used only for financial transaction. That's why Bitcoin is a digital currency. That is based on the technology called blockchain. So blockchain is a technology that record, whatever happens in the digital sphere, and nobody can track or hack or cheat that recording system. And Bitcoin is operated through a blockchain application. And friends, the days to come, what is going to see is that everything in the world will be recorded through blockchain application. So birth, death, title ownership, marriage certificates, driving licenses, insurance claims, medical procedures, everything will be a blockchain enabled. A new world will be coming. Everything will be expressed through codes. Friends, human world will be codified with data. So we humans will become just codes. Our values are reduced to just numbers. We don't have any essential inherent human quality in the days to come. Our life will be reduced to just feeding data, just digital codes. A dangerous scenario will prevail. Imagine, friends, today, genome sequencing is possible within few hours. So synthetic biology is the next, target technology. It's not evolved fully, but in the days to come, when you are in your 30 plus, I'm sure when you are in 30 plus, there will be what may be called a synthetic biology. And when synthetic biology comes, friends, what is synthetic biology? Synthetic biology is a multidisciplinary area of research, that seeks to create a new biological parts, that is a living material, a living material. What happens, friends? In the days to come, synthetic biology helps you create living material. Friends, once it is matured, we can use synthetic hand, synthetic leg, synthetic parts of our human body. And that will be living materials. So you can replace your hand with a synthetic hand. Imagine a scenario. It's a dangerous scenario, right? So humans are preferring, synthetic living. There will be days, friends, certainly there will be days humans will prefer a synthetic living hand or synthetic living leg instead of a human living leg or human living hand. That days are not far, friends. That is, within 10 years, we will witness all these kinds of technologies, friends. And it will have profound, profound impacts on our life. And the impact of this, fourth industrial revolution, friends, I will be talking next day from Oduwai Gorge to Karman Line. My next lecture will be that the impact of this fourth industrial revolution or the AI revolution. Friends, now the floor is open for discussion. Friends, you can talk to me.